My name is Ed Begley, and this is I've Got a Secret.
I've Got a Secret, brought to you tonight by Tony, creator of fine beauty products for the woman who preserves the natural look of beauty care at home. Live from New York, here is I've Got a Secret, starring Garry Moore.
Thank you very much. Good evening, friends, and welcome to another edition of I've Got a Secret. The first order of business, as usual, is to meet the members of our panel. Tonight, sitting in for the vacationing Bill Cullen, we have a gentleman who taught Bill and the rest of us how to play this game 12 years ago because he and a partner invented I've Got a Secret. He has since become a celebrity on his own right, our old friend Allan Sherman. See who they are. Next is Betsy Palmer.
Good evening.
And then there's Henry Morgan, and there's Bess Myerson. So we're all on the group. There you go. Allan, I don't believe you have ever been on our panel before,
nope.
Have you? You know how the game goes and everything?
I think I remember, yeah.
All right, now we have our first contestant then, please. Will you come in, sir? You tell our panel, please, what your name is and where you are from.
I'm Dr. Edward O. Thorpe, and I'm from Las Cruces, New Mexico.
This is Dr. Thorpe from New Mexico. And panel, you may have read about Dr. Thorpe in the papers recently. He is a professor of mathematics at New Mexico State University. A few weeks ago, years ago, he became interested in the mathematical theory of probability as applied to the gentle art of gambling. Now, Dr. Thorpe, what stimulated your interest in this field?
I was going on a vacation to Las Vegas, Nevada, and I read about how to play blackjack efficiently in a mathematics journal.
In a mathematics journal?
There's quite a tie-in between mathematics and probability theory. It's been going on for hundreds of years.
Yeah, I suppose that's so. So you went to Las Vegas, and you took $10 with you as a starter, and what happened?
Well, after about 40 minutes, I lost $8.50, and the other players were annihilated, so I got very interested in all this.
So you had somewhat of a victory because you didn't lose as much as the rest of the people. Right. So then he decided that he was going to go home and work out a real mathematical theory, which he did. He wrote a paper on the subject. He delivered it to the National Meeting of American Mathematicians Society. And what was the result? What was the reception there when you presented this paper?
Well, the place was packed, and they rose as a body afterwards to come forward to get the copies I brought along.
He had the system put on a mimeograph sheet, and all these professors came up, and everybody took one. All right, now you finally took the theory that you presented on the paper, and you put it into application on a scientific field trip to Las Vegas. How did you make out?
Well, we played 5 days on this first trip, and we won $11,000.
Won $11,000. And as I'm sure you've all read in the papers, the result of Dr. Thorpe's investigations was that the rules of blackjack were changed in Las Vegas. Now, we'll talk about this a little more later on, but now Dr. Thorpe has a secret for you to guess. So, Dr. Thorpe, if you'll whisper your secret to me, we'll show it at the same time for the audience. In that event, I, too, have a secret to tell you about. Panel, to help you classify Dr. Thorpe's secret, the clue concerns something he's going to do. My secret concerns something I'm going to do. We'll start the game with Bess Myers.
Dr. Thorpe, are you and Garry perhaps going to play a game of blackjack?
No.
I ain't going to play with him.
Something you're going to do. Are you going to do it tonight here on the stage?
No, I'm not.
Are you going to do it?
I would have to give you a half-correct answer on that.
Well, will part of what you're going to do be done outside of New York City?
Yes.
$20 down, $60 to go. And to keep matters accurate, Doctor, I know you're interested in accuracy, his portion, his secret, will be done here in New York City, probably in this theater. My resulting secret will be done outside New York City. All right, we have $20 down, $60 to go. We go to Allan Sherman.
Do we want to know what Garry's part of it is, too?
Yes.
Will Garry's part be done in Las Vegas or in any place where there's gambling?
Yes.
Legal gambling? Will Garry have to go there to do it?
No.
Will there be somebody sitting there representing Garry, or standing there?
I would say, in a manner of speaking, yes.
Will this take place tonight?
No.
Is it important when it'll take place?
No, not really.
No.
I understand it, Dr. Thorpe, your part of the secret is going to take place tonight, is it not?
Well, some of it.
Some of it, and then there'll be later developments. All right, fine.
Has this got anything to do with your system of playing blackjack?
Yes.
$40 down, $40 to go. We go, please, to Betsy.
Dr. Thorpe, are you going to take Garry's money? And are you going to play with his money?
Oh, no.
No. You're not going to play with money at all.
Dr. Thorpe's not going to play for money, no.
No.
No, you're going to play with money, not for money.
No.
With money.
No.
Is it gambling that you're going to do?
No.
Oh, it's not gambling. Is it going to be done, no gambling involved.
We didn't say that. His secret is
he
not
knows
that he
what
is
he's
going
doing, but it's a gamble on your part of the side of the ledger. Is that it?
Further and further in left field. $60 down, $20 to go. We go to Henry Morgan, please.
Doctor, if you're going to do your part here, and Garry's part is going to be done away, are you going to show him how your system works?
No.
You're going to show anybody?
Yes.
Henry, Dr. Thorpe's secret is going to be of particular interest to you. As you may remember, a few days ago, we asked you if you could get away for a few days this week, right? You said that you could, and that's the only information we gave you, right?
Oh, wait. Listen, if it's gambling with money, not me.
No. Listen, we've asked Dr. Thorpe to teach you his mathematical theories, and then in the interest of pure science...
I can lose even with this thing.
We're going to send you out of the country to an unspecified location where gambling is legal, and you're going to get a chance to try out the theories that you are about to learn.
Wait. With whose dough?
That will be revealed later. Now, Henry, we know...
No, later. I can't
go. It'll be our money. Don't worry.
Oh, good.
Listen, we went to Tahoe with Henry, the whole troop, and I can tell you, he's not a gambler. He tries, but he's not a gambler. I'll tell you that. He did not do very well. But since you do have an interest in pure mathematics, this should be challenging for you. If you'll come center, Henry, we have a blackboard on which Dr. Thorpe will give you a few preliminary pointers.
With your money? Oh, boy, good luck to us all.
Can you just give us a touch on the basic idea?
Sure. If you were a mathematician, I'd tell you that, let's assume you are, I'd tell you that the gist of the system is in this formula right here.
Doctor, which is heads? I don't even know.
I'm sorry. We're going to launch you at the Caribbean. You've got it.
Go. What is the basic premise?
Over unfavorable situations, you make small bets. This sum here represents a sum over these situations with negative expectation. The XIs represent expectation here. Little PIs, probabilities. Little ones are unit bets. Over here, we have a sum over positive.
Henry, never mind. You're not getting it. I can tell by looking at you. Now,
it's not coming through.
Here are your sealed orders. This envelope contains your airline tickets plus $100 to invest. The proceeds of any winnings will go to your favorite charity. If you should happen to lose, we will still send $100 to your favorite charity. Now, Henry, we're with you in mind and spirit. Dr. Thorpe, be sure to watch the show next week to see what kind of a math student Henry turns out to be. I have an idea that all he's going to learn is that you should not gamble unless you are a Ph.D. in mathematics.
Oh, he's going to learn he should not trust me, but it's just...
I think we'll have to depend on luck for this one.
Maybe so, but you'll teach him. Thank you very much, Dr. Thorpe.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Good luck for you.
We'll be back with you again in just a moment, but first, let's watch this. Now, may we welcome our next contestant, please. Will you come in? Hi, how are you? Would you tell our panel, please, what your name is and where you're from?
My name is Robert Phillips, and I'm from Donbrook, New Jersey.
This is Robert Phillips from New Jersey, and what do you have under this cover, Bob?
24 potatoes.
Oh, sure, who doesn't? 24 potatoes he's got under here. May I ask what you do with these 24 potatoes?
That's my secret.
All right, you whisper your secret to me. We'll show the audience what we're going, what you're going to do. All right. Panel, the clue to Robert's secret concerns what he does with these potatoes. We'll start the game with, let's start with Allan Sherman.
Do you turn them into something else or some other form of potato? Are they raw?
Yes.
Do you cook them in any way?
No.
Are they, when you're finished with them, will they be edible?
No.
Or do you make any artistic thing out of them?
You mean like a sculpture or something, yeah. Something with a design? No.
Do you make any mechanical thing out of them? Use them for any mechanical purpose?
No.
You make mashed potatoes?
You make mashed potatoes out of them? No. $20 down, $60 to go. We go, please, to Betsy.
Do you use them in any way the potatoes are usually used, Robert?
No.
Will they make a noise when you get finished with them?
No.
No?
Well, no, the potatoes will make no noise.
They'll
just lie there and potate.
Yes. But do you use the potatoes in respect to something else? Is there something else involved with your potatoes?
Yes.
That you apply the potatoes to? Is it an instrument of some sort, a musical instrument?
Yes.
But not in the sense that it's something that an individual plays, like a violin. And it's something that can produce music, but it is not a musical instrument. So we go to Henry Morgan.
Oh, the thing that you use the potatoes against or with, is it household items?
Yes.
Like pans or something like that?
No, pots? Not in that sense. This would not be found in the household department. But it could be, but what he's going to use it with can be used in the home and is.
Is it more percussion than string? It's not a wind instrument, so it's got to be something you hit, so it is percussion, right? All right, we'll rate the whole thing.
Henry, let me remind you, I said it was not a musical instrument in the sense it was something that you blow or play on or perform upon.
No, I think I do. Yeah, I do.
$60 down, $20 to go. We go, please, to bed.
Explain it to me.
He's going
to
hit something with
the
potato.
I know he is. Are you going to throw the potatoes at an object?
No.
No. We are going to hear a sound, though, because the potato is going to come into contact with something else, right?
No.
No?
Well, let's say the potatoes will be connected to something else.
Connected. Are you going to sew the potatoes?
There's a pretty picture. A fellow sitting down hem stitching a potato. Panel, 13-year-old Robert Phillips recently used these potatoes to win first prize at the Rutgers University Fair. It was not an agricultural fair, it was a science fair. And he won with a very ingenious new use for potatoes. He made them into a battery that actually powers his portable radio. Now, there are your 24 potatoes. Here's the little radio. Now, let's see. We have an unattached potato here. And as you can see, I hope, each potato has been covered with wax for two reasons. First, to keep the wires stuck into it. And second, to keep any moisture from escaping, because the moisture is essential. Now, what do you have inside each of these potatoes, Bob?
Inside each potato, I have four zincs and four copper.
That's four zinc plates and four copper plates. Now, you started out on this project originally to build a normal chemical battery. What happened?
It didn't work.
Well, that's luck. Now then, this is the part that interests me. After he had failed to build a standard battery, his father told him about seeing a demonstration right here on I've Got a Secret a few years ago. You may recall that we lit a pumpkin with a battery made out of a grapefruit, utilizing the acids in the grapefruit as a source of electrical energy. What kind of luck did you have with the grapefruit?
Oh, it worked very good, except the plates were eaten up very fast.
Acid was too strong, huh?
Yes.
Now, then, what did you experiment with next?
All different fruits and vegetables.
Well, about 50 different kinds, bananas, oranges, apples, and the whole doggone thing. Now, all of these produced electricity, but he found out he got the most voltage out of a potato. How much voltage do you have in these potatoes?
6 volts.
6 volts, but you can generate up to 24 volts,
yes.
Right? Why does a potato produce electricity?
Because in the potato, there are acids that react with the plates. And gives an electrical current.
All right, well, now we've got the radio here. It is not attached to anything, as you can see. I will turn it on.
It is.
It is already turned on, and we hear nothing. All right, now he takes two little plugs, just like you get on earphones, puts them into these jacks. One.
He goes back, 8B, Beverly.
I better turn it off before a rival commercial comes on here.
Bobbert, I admire you more than I can tell you. You're a very ingenious and patient young man. If you get something new, come back and see us again. Now it is time for us to meet our special guest for tonight. You will soon be seeing him co-starring in the movie version of The Unsinkable Molly Brown. Here is the distinguished actor, Mr. Ed Begley.
Good to see you again, my friend.
Now, panel, Ed Begley has brought along some material that I think that you're going to find fascinating. It's a collection of really priceless recordings. Will you tell our panel about them?
Well, I became interested in historical records, Garry, when I played the part of William Jennings Bryan in the Broadway show Inherit the Wind. Bryan had been called the silver-tongued orator, and I got to wondering what he really sounded like.
Well, now, thanks to a gentleman sitting in our audience right now, we'll have opportunity to find that out. His name is G. Robert Vinson. He is curator of the newly created National Voice Library at Michigan State University in East Lansing, Michigan. Mr. Vinson, will you please stand up and take a bow for us, sir? Thank you. Now, Mr. Vincent is currently involved in cataloging approximately 16,000 recordings of famous voices and events, which will be available to students from all over the world. Mr. Vincent has lent us some of these great recordings tonight, and just to get things started, we're going to play a recording of William Jennings Bryan, made in 1904. I'm curious to see, panel, if you notice any similarity between his voice and the voice of a very famous actor. Let's listen.
Imperialism is the policy of an empire, and an empire is a nation composed of different races living under varying forms of government. A republic cannot be an empire, for a republic rests upon the theory that governments derive their just powers from the consent of the governed, and colonialism violates this theory.
Henry has his hand up. Betsy has an eye. Everybody seems to have an opinion.
Well, I think that it bears quite a similarity to Mr. Begley.
Yes.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. It struck us immediately. Well, panel, now we have some other voices we're going to play for you. Let's see if you can identify them. Ed, will you tell us about the first one, please?
Well, this recording was made in 1924 by a very famous motion picture actor who is not known for his singing, as you will soon hear, because he is singing on this record.
All right, let's show the audience the name of the gentleman involved. All right, now that we know who it is, let's hear the record. Shim, please. All right, I see. Well, Betsy, I'll call on you first this time.
Rudolph Valentino.
Rudolph Valentino. Very good.
Only because of the language that he was singing in, it was kind of.
Well, my staff tells me that he was singing in Spanish, but with an Italian accent.
With an Italian accent, it sounded Italian, yes.
All right, Ed, what do we have next?
Well, the next recording is a speech delivered to a political convention in 1912.
All right, let's get the name of the gentleman. No, that's the wrong super. I tell you what, let's do. Let's keep that card up, but it does not belong to a political figure. We had our cards mixed here. But let's now hear the voice. It was
needless to say, I am rather satisfied with the thought that if, in spite of the great distance that will be separating us, you hear my voice as clearly and as distinctly as I think you should, I am personally responsible to a certain extent for this rather remarkable feat.
Now, will you read the clue, Mr. Begley, please?
This recording you've just heard is of a radio broadcast to the United States from this gentleman's yacht somewhere in the Mediterranean. The recording was made in 1929.
Betsy's and Henry's hands went up in unison, so.
No.
No, you go.
Oh, you're not sure, right?
Well, I think it's Marconi.
You, that's who you think it is, that's who it is.
Did you see?
No.
Hey, you're very, very sharp. Oh, you, who did you think it was, honey?
I'm not going to tell.
Oh!
All righty.
Now we have, what was the description?
Now, the recording that I thought was coming up next is coming up now. And this next recording is a speech delivered, as I said before, to a political convention in 1912.
Here we go. Here's the man's name. And here is his voice.
To you who gird yourselves for this great new fight in the never-ending warfare for the good of humankind, I say we stand at Armageddon, and we battle for the Lord.
A very famous phrase, we stand at Armageddon and do battle for the Lord.
American? I'll make a wild one.
All right.
Billy Sunday.
No.
I would say an Englishman.
Yes.
He's an Englishman?
Why would he be the
He's an American politician at a presidential campaign.
William Jennings Bryan.
Not William Jennings Bryan. No. Wilson. Who was it?
Teddy Roosevelt?
Teddy Roosevelt. Yes, sir.
You know, now that's a shocking thing. I cheated, see. I thought 1912, that it's political, must be Teddy Roosevelt. Then I listened, and because I got a big brain, I thought myself out of the right answer.
You gotta hang in there, Henry. You're going to be great in the Caribbean.
Oh, boy.
Actually, Theodore Roosevelt was addressing the Bull Moose Convention. Now, Ed.
This next recording was made in 1909. I won't tell you anything else about it, but if you know your history and listen carefully, you should know it.
Let's show the name of the person involved. And now we will go to the recording, please.
The expedition left New York on the 6th of July, 1908, in the steamer Roosevelt, commanded by Captain Robert A. Bartlett, was reviewed by President Roosevelt and steamed northward, arriving at Cape York, North Greenland, the 1st of August.
All right, there's more to it, but Henry's hand shot up almost before the first four words were out. Bess, you think you know, you haven't had a crack at it.
That's right.
Admiral Peary? I thought Bird.
No, I say LaGuardia.
Peary.
Perry.
Absolutely
Perry.
Right.
Perry.
Admiral Perry, of course, who was the this discoverer of the North Pole in 1909. Right. Henry, you had your hand up like a shot. How come?
Right.
See, because I got to win one.
All right, Ed, let's give him another chance.
This next one goes way back. The woman whose voice you're about to hear was born in 1820. The recording was made in 1890, and the quality leaves something to be desired, so listen carefully.
Here is the name of the person involved, and here is the recording, Shim.
Well, I am no better, even at Begley. Just and day.
When I am no longer even a memory, just a name,
I hope my voice sings a history, the great work of my life.
I hope my voice brings to history the great work of my life.
Come, then, my dear old comrade of Salad Lava.
God bless my dear old comrades of Balaclava.
Now, Henry's had his hand up, and Betsy's had hers up, and Allan had his halfway up. Allan, you want
to... I left when she got to Balaclava.
Oh, really? All right, let's take Henry.
I think it's Queen Victoria.
You do? Who do you think it is, Betsy?
I say it's Sarah Bernhardt.
Oh, really? At Balaclava? The Battle of Balaclava she refers to was in the...
Nightingale.
Yes, the Crimean War. And that's all we have time for. Oh, dear, we have a bugle call here, which I want to play for you after the show. It's the bugle call, or the fellow recreating the bugle call that started the charge of the Light Brigade.
Oh,
really?
Into the Valley of...
Death Road... No, that isn't... Yes, that's it.
Yes. In the Valley of Death Road to 600. Ed Begley, it's been a joy having you with us, you newlywed, and thank you so much. And continue to give it...
Thank you.
Well, we'll be back with you again after this important message. Allan Sherman, my friend, we are tremendously grateful to you for being with us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
Next week, we're having another sex symbol, Louis Jourdan,
Whee!
Who will be replacing Bill Cullen. Also, Olivia de Havilland will be here. Bill, Henry, be sure to report to Dr. Thorpe right after the show for math lessons. Here's the bugle call, and good night.
My name is Ed Begley, and this is I've Got a Secret.
I've Got a Secret, brought to you tonight by Tony, creator of fine beauty products, for the woman who prefers the natural look of beauty care at home. Live from New York, here is I've Got a Secret, starring Garry Moore.
Thank you very much. Good evening, friends, and welcome to another edition of I've Got a Secret. The first order of business, as usual, is to meet the members of our panel. Tonight, sitting in for the vacationing Bill Cullen, we have a gentleman who taught Bill and the rest of us how to play this game 12 years ago because he and a partner invented I've Got a Secret. He has since become a celebrity on his own right, our old friend Allan Sherman. See who they are. Next is Betsy Palmer.
Good evening.
And then there's Henry Morgan, and there's Bess Myerson. So we're pulling on the group. There you go. Allan, I don't believe you have ever been on our panel before,
no.
Have you? You know how the game goes and everything?
I think I remember, yeah.
All right, now we have our first contestant then, please. Will you come in, sir? You tell our panel, please, what your name is and where you are from.
I'm Dr. Edward O. Thorpe, and I'm from Las Cruces, New Mexico.
This is Dr. Thorpe from New Mexico. And panel, you may have read about Dr. Thorpe in the papers recently. He is a professor of mathematics at New Mexico State University. A few weeks ago, years ago, he became interested in the mathematical theory of probability as applied to the gentle art of gambling. Now, Dr. Thorpe, what stimulated your interest in this field?
I was going on a vacation to Las Vegas, Nevada, and I read about how to play blackjack efficiently in a mathematics journal.
In a mathematics journal?
There's quite a tie-in between mathematics and probability theory. It's been going on for hundreds of years.
Yeah, I suppose that's so. So you went to Las Vegas, and you took $10 with you as a starter, and what happened?
Well, after about 40 minutes, I lost $8.50, and the other players were annihilated, so I got very interested in all this.
So you had somewhat of a victory.